Public's welcome to be part of it. So, how do you want to start? I did meet with Kate and Marie yesterday to go over some of the capital improvement things that are on our list, and we'll get to those hopefully toward the end of our meeting. But before that, we should start talking about next year's budget. We're here to talk about next year's budget. It's going to be difficult. We do not yet know what the tuition costs are. We have not yet been informed. And I believe the contract says they have to tell us by the 15th.
I looked it up. December 1st.
December 1st.
But last year, they did an exception to the rule. I think when we're looking at doing the contract again, you need to look at that. But last year, they gave it to us earlier.
Okay.
I sent another email today.
Thank you. So we do not know tuition costs, so that's an unknown. The first year it went up almost 1.8%. The second year it went up almost 3.5%. So we have no idea what it might be going up and this year. And I assume it's going to go up. I've never seen it go down. The other thing we don't know, of course, are health costs increases.
What I'm projecting is kind
of... Yeah, please. Yeah, that's why we're here.
So right now, I'm projecting 8% increase, keeping it in single digits, hoping it's lower. We'll know by the second week of November what that percentage is, because we know the rate. It's a guesstimate right now. So I'm projecting in the budget proposal, unless I get something before you guys get distributed the proposal, you're going to see a 8% increase.
And so I think we can talk about specifics, but I'm just going to ask Marie and Connie and anyone else in the administration who knows how many other costs that are other costs, not things, other things that might go up in cost that are like contracted items.
The bus?
The bus, yes, and I looked up the bus is going up. I have a review in my other bag. It's going up. No, about 5,000.
I plugged everything in.
You plugged in the right number.
Oh, wait. I have it
right there, actually.
Wait,
I'll
have it here.
Yeah, keep talking.
All right, so the bus contract goes up, but it goes up every year. We signed the contract a couple of years ago in December, and it shows an increase every year. Assuming the price of diesel. I think, and so far we've been fortunate. There have been some spikes because of the hurricanes and the cost, but it hasn't gone up, hasn't stayed up.
I don't have it.
All right, so anyway, that's up a bit. She found it. I can tell that by looking. She found it.
Yeah, about five.
And then there are some things that obviously other things that we need to look at, because we're looking at, I believe, another year in our 5-year plan of technology, and maybe something in addition to that too. I don't know. So we can start sort of marching through some of the things. And just to be sure, do people around the table right now have things that they want to look at specifically as we to make sure we don't forget about them?
No, I'm interested to see what capital improvement stuff for this year versus what we did last year.
Yep.
Place we can perhaps make some.
Yeah, I think those are some things to look at. What might be warrants, what we might be able to, what we might want to put into the into the operating budget, some things we might want to make warrants together.
Okay.
Good. Aaron?
Thanks. I think, we can concentrate a little more again on the technology piece. It's just the stuff. I know it costs more. There might be things down the line that we might want to consider that we're putting off. I don't know what those are, but if we can, the stuff is going to get used. So.
All right, then let's start looking at that. I will say, so that Tom hears this very clearly. Well, when I was in the meeting over with Kate and Marie, Kate kept saying, look, I hear the board, I hear Tom saying, tell us everything that really needs to happen. Don't you, Kate and Marie, make decisions before the school board gets to know what is really needed. And Tom has been saying this for years, years and years and years, that we have to know, we have to know the real stuff that we need. So, and I believe that's pretty much what you've done this year. And we appreciate that, so.
So I'll just preface the, as it comes around, that I, given what the board's objective has been for a couple of years, which is to find places to reduce costs so that we can put money into this, was what we've been trying to do for a number of years. And for a number of years, that was personnel that we were reducing. So this year I tried, or I'm presenting, what I'm proposing to you is not adding any money except for a couple of lines. So print media, general supplies, custodial supplies, all of that stuff staying flat, which they're substantially less than they were 5 years ago, but trying to stay flat and continue to stay flat, and then continuing to put money into maintenance and technology, the two areas that I'm suggesting we need to put money. So the first one on there is computer hardware line, and that's a detailed breakout of the things I'm suggesting that we need in the building. The third column is what we budgeted for this year, the suggested cost for 18-19, and then the differential is the third.
All right, but we had budgeted. This is our third year on the 5-year plan, or the second year on the 5-year plan?
Third,
I think, right? Could it just be the second?
I think it's the third.
Okay,
I'm pretty sure it's the third.
And so this almost 40,000, is that what we had budgeted, correct?
Yeah, a few things have changed.
Yeah.
So originally we were going to do more iPads than we were going to do Chromebooks. But what we're finding, particularly with our older students, so like third through sixth grade, is that they need to do a lot more word processing than we are able to do with iPads. It's a really difficult thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're looking at having more of a balance, iPads being in the annex for kids and are accessible to the younger kids, but having more Chromebooks. We're also a Google school, and so that allows them to share and collaborate.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that
explains
the difference.
Kathleen, okay.
Middle school too, so that's a good.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Great. Can I ask you a question about just the technology? Is there any additional cost for software?
So that is a line. It was increased last year. I'm not asking for an additional increase this year. Tom has changed our billing for several of the software things, like security, so it's every other year. They're 2-year licenses, so that can stay flat rather than having a bubble year that seems more expensive, and so we're not asking for any more of the software.
Okay.
Other questions on that line, the hardware line at the moment? Do you want to keep going, Kate, with your contracted specialist pieces?
So Tom LaBelle has been our IT person long before I've joined RGS, and every year he donates a ton of hours to the school. You'll see it on the invoices that come in. He shows you what he worked and then what he's billing you for and how much he's donating. In addition, he does our STEM club on Monday afternoons for our kids, so just to do that for them. He's just an important part of our community. And I'm super grateful, and I think he'll continue to donate hours, but I also feel like he should be paid for his work. His work is invaluable. Additionally, the more technology we have, the more hours we need him. So it's not just that he should be finally paid for his work. We also have a lot more work for him to do than we've ever had before with the additional one-to-one capabilities in the school. So it's just what he should be compensated for his work.
So this did not come from Tom LaBella. This came from you thinking he deserves to be recognized for the extra hour. He's a resident in town. He donates his time. He's very, very generous. I completely agree with that.
I guess the biggest piece for me, in addition to him being compensated, is that he's working far more hours than he was even 3 years ago. He's here all summer long just trying to get us back up and running.
Mm-hmm.
Whether it's installing all the new software and replace servers, and that means a ton of work for him. So there's just a lot of work for him to do. So he's working substantially more hours than he was three or 5 years ago.
Thank you. That's good to know. Yeah. Thank you. Any questions?
Did you have a concern about this?
No. I just wondered if it came from Tom, if he was suggesting that.
Tom and I always talk about
his
salary every year when I get to this spot. He's a resident of the town, so it's really hard for him because he wants to be able to support the town, but he also needs to pay for his work. So, and we did acknowledge in our conversation the increase. increase in workload is substantial.
Yeah. And that's good to know, now that we have even more different types of technology.
I'm wondering if this is enough.
I feel like it's fair compensation for the increased workload.
How did you arrive at the...
So he has a billable hours out, like rate, and then we look at the hours, and that's where you come up with the...
Because if he's putting in a lot of extra hours, I mean, and that's like, you can't really put a price tag on, especially when you're volunteering, because we would have vetted that out somewhere else.
We actually looked at that my first year. We did a comparison between Back Bay and Tom. It was pretty comparable, if I remember correctly. It was almost like exactly comparable price-wise. I think the great thing about them not consulting Back Bay, because they've been great, Tom is just intimately involved with the school and the nuances of this building and the layout and how they had to wire it, and that's been a real benefit for us.
And especially with the increase, like you said, it's increased hours and time that he's putting in, and, you know, sort of like an on-call, you know.
And he's here right now.
Yeah.
he's always available, which is really nice. So I feel really fortunate that he's so intimately involved with the complicated.
Yeah, he's very. He does a lot of time for the town hall as well, and other places. So he's invaluable, and so to get him compensated a bit more fairly is not unreasonable.
The only reason I brought that up was because, you know, this is something that I hate when we're, as a town, when we're cheap when it comes to the folks that work here that help us, because they're doing the entire community's service. So, you know, I would absolutely advocate for increasing that if you thought that was reasonable, because that's the kind of stuff that, in the long run, we would pay so much for. I mean, really, and it's not just the service, it can be done whenever. He's there when you maybe look what time it is, you know, he's here. So that's just my thought on that.
Anyone else on?
Can I back up to the last? The laptops versus the Chromebooks, what's the difference there?
Laptops are for adults. So Chromebooks don't have the capabilities that the laptops do because they're simpler. You understand that. So for teachers, having their laptops is important. And so that's part of our recycling. Yeah, so we have some that are 8 years old, some that are 5 years old, so I give them.
Okay, thank you. Yep.
We'll keep going down this and get into the custodial stuff now, please.
So the first under custodial salaries was a proposal for a 2% raise for our two custodians, Dick and Thornton.
Yep, and I'll just comment on that is that what we usually do is try to follow the town, and the town has consistently been 2% over the last, you know, sometimes it's 1.5%, sometimes it's 2.5%, somewhere around 2%. So we try to follow what the town employees are doing. But it's not unreasonable to what we've been doing.
And then the second under custodial salaries is a proposal for an additional part-time person about 8 hours a week during the school year. Thursday nights are our biggest nights here. There's always, most often, there are events here. And we're looking to have somebody on Thursdays as a person that can be here through the evening. Because ultimately, people want to use the building, but we're saying we have to close it 6 or 8, because it can't be in the building without it. And we used to have 2 full-times, so it works differently. So it's just unfortunate. And we need the help desperately. The second is for one person for 20 hours a week for 5 weeks of the summer. So as you know, the work that's done here over the summer is incredible. And we're burning them out, and they need some support to help with the work. An example of that would be they did a great job this summer, but the list of things, I think I've even shared with you, Judy, that are intended to be done to the building, the front steps, the flagpole, all of these smaller projects, they could be doing those over the summer if there was another person, and we don't even have time to get to those things. And once the school year starts, it's even harder because their job is different, what they do with their time is different. And additionally, they don't take any vacations in the summer because there's so much to do. And then now they're taking Dick's on vacation for 2 weeks right now. I'm so glad, and he deserves it, and he should be. It's just not a great time to have down to one custodian for 2 weeks. It's really challenging. So we're trying to figure out a way to make that happen. And it felt like that was a way to get more done in the summer and alleviate some of the vacation struggles.
And these would be hourly employees, obviously, or one hourly employee that works out. Yeah, so it's not costed out because we don't know what the cost would be yet on doing something.
It'll be in the, when Murray presents the budget, I guess, month or so, it'll be in there.
We talked about the town trying to, you know, share resources or try to, and I'm wondering if, you know, doing some of this, and maybe it means additional hours or, you know, in order to help the town meet its needs, you know, as well.
I think it's a good question. In terms of custodial help, the town only hires one part-time custodian for the town hall. I believe that's the only custodial help we have. It's interesting, and I will be announcing this publicly at the school board meeting, but we have a new road agent. And the only other help we have is part-time help. We have one new full-time road agent, and the only people we have is part-time help. So I think in terms of, I don't think there's anything we can take over for the town, and I'm not sure there's anything the town can help us with, but it's worth having the conversation.
Okay.
Always. Okay.
The next is just maintenance repairs. This is the line that we've been trying to make some improvements or repairs or maintenance or get back up into working order for a number of years. So Dick's first year, 4 years ago, he did all LED lights in the building. And got a grant to offset that, but now we're at the point that they all need to be replaced building-wide because they only last about 4 years, and so we need to budget for that because that's a bigger project. Given that we've already made the conversion to LED, there's not offsetting grant money like there was when we made the original conversion. That being said, it's also, as you saw in Dick's presentation a couple years ago, a substantial savings just by converting to the light bulbs every year in terms of electric. Our phone and bell system, they no longer make this model or either model of the phone or the bell system, and they no longer have replacement parts for them because they're so old. Recently our bell system went down very start of the school year, and they had to find a part on an old non-working one to put in because they don't even manufacture them anymore. So we're working, but not well. And I don't know how many times you've called them and hung up on you in the middle of a phone call, or we attempt you because our phones don't work spectacularly.
Yeah,
well.
I think you've said to me twice.
Yeah, it happens often.
Probably not on purpose.
I don't know about that. Sometimes.
Maybe.
That's my excuse. So we've been, Dick has been talking to a couple different companies about a full replacement building-wide and having one system and trying to have it all be one automated system. So he's been pricing that out. The pipe installation in the annex, you know, the pipes, the hot water heater pipes that run through the top of the rooms, they're not all insulated, and that's just, we're losing heat that way, and it's not safe in rooms, and so he'd like to finish that project. Paint rotation, we did the annex, I don't know, maybe you've seen it, it looks fantastic, it's clean, it's fresh, it just, it's so much less stimulus for the kids, it's really nice. So the plan has been to always have the floors on rotation to keep doing that, so the supplies for that. We have a couple of exterior upgrades that need to take place, just some piping, bricks, things of that nature that need to be tended to. As you know, trying to come here and get in the back door, even though the timer says it's working, it's never working. And that's a safety issue. And so the company comes pretty often to try to reset it or figure it out. It's just not, it's an old system, it doesn't work. The front door will stick or not lock, and so we're out there jiggling and rattling it, and it's just old and it needs to be updated and repaired. At the same time, we would also like to add the door down between the kindergarten and the annex, the same automatic lock and unlock, because the kindergarten kids go out that way and come in that way, as do the annex kids now, so it would just be another really safe and secure entrance and exit.
So I have a question. Just for everybody to know. So every time you call somebody from security to come in
for the people. Sometimes, yes. Sometimes
so,
they're already coming for something else.
I'm saying. So that would be a cost, it's a cost savings.
Like our bell system would have broke just to come $800.
Yeah.
I'm in dispute with the company as we speak.
Well, and, yeah, and as I look at this, and I see general maintenance 10K. So originally it was in our current budget, it's at 55,000. And all this, I mean, we have some 15,000 phone and bell, 15,000 door, 12,000 seal coated. I mean, all these things for another 10, we're thinking we can get all this done. And I also want to make the point that it's not just external telephone calls, it's internal. And to me, that's a safety measure. It is not just a communication necessary, it's a safety measure. Like, people need to be able to contact each other in the building without having to count on their cell phones. We all know how spotty cell phone service is in this town, so.
I know, I don't want cell phones out.
and cell phones aren't allowed, apparently, so, you know. Okay, so thoughts, questions?
What are you seal coated?
All of the new pavement would be all seal coated. We only have a little bit of pavement out here, but it's not desperate. The front was done and we're all of it, so there's just that little bit left. But it just how it's explained to me from Dick was that it just preserves it for that much longer, and since we just did it, it makes sense to have it done so we don't have to look at repaving anytime soon. I mean, it's finally in the state where it needs to be. There's no major potholes, it's squared off and flat, it's safe for our kids, there's no giant pools of ice in the winter, so. We'd like to do that.
Is his recommendation that we do it every year?
No, I guess you don't. You do it once, like every 5 or 6 years or something like that.
You
say
to do it right away.
Yeah.
You can do that.
Yeah.
Okay, let's keep it going.
Yes, I'm on. Yes.
So,
savings.
Yes. We no longer do NEWA testing. We do just Children's Progress, K through third grade. We don't do the NEWA through sixth grade, so that's a cost savings of $4,400. Sorry, any questions about that? Library print media, so the Apple voucher program is now in full effect. And so it used to be that you could buy an app and you could push it out onto 20 iPads and sort of just like a $3.99 or $6.99. Apple has since realized they could make a lot more money by doing it differently, and now it's a cost per app on each device. And there are a number of apps that we know of on our devices, and we're essentially, if we don't do this, we'd be breaking the law, and so we need to put money in. It's a one-time $1,500, and then it would be like $200 or $300 every year if you want new apps, but we're just trying to get what we know we use all the time on all of the apps in the building. All the iPads.
So this is this $1,500 increase is essentially a change in the way Apple's doing business, and
so nothing extra, zero.
Oh yeah, but it's not $35,000. Sorry,
extra zero on there.
You suggested, yeah.
Clerical Caroline is phenomenal at her job. She is exceptional. She is the light of the school. She's so pleasant and kind to all the families and the kids. She knows what the staff needs before the staff even needs it and makes sure it's accomplished. She's just fantastic. We did not suggest a raise last year because it was her first year, and I think she's earned the raise tenfold.
And again, we did follow this is usually what we also agree to. Staff here. So. Questions, comments, thoughts on that so far? We've got one last one.
And then just the decrease in the tuition workshop reimbursement. Staff is in their contract to take college classes, and we base that number on the number of staff that are looking to take college classes, and there's less people interested in taking college classes right now.
Well, it may not be an interest, it also may be that people have attained a certain level and are happy where they are.
Oh, not that they're not interested in doing
right,
that,
right,
because
right,
they may
right.
have
like, yeah,
a million other things they need to be
I didn't
doing.
I
so.
The impression that they weren't interested
in they're always learning.
So, okay, the same as that. All right, so overall, it wasn't a grand total.
No, you don't know.
Direction to Marie, I would say, is to mind the safety, to put these in, and we'll take a look at it in the whole, when we see them.
So, it's not going to without the personnel changes, like the salary stuff, it's plus 22.
The thing is, it is plus 22 here. I just want to remind the board that had in the current budget, we have $50,000 in there to put in trust fund, because that was voted to do so. That will be zeroed out, so that will, your budget will be decreased by that amount. You're not gonna need it. Again, unless you decide to put the warrant article again, then we have to add it back on. But initially, when the board presents the initial budget, to start with, it has not been anything in that line. And the other thing I want to remind the board is that the three warrant articles, or the two warrant articles that was passed, was also put in the maintenance line. So that's the $45,500 and the $80,000. That will also decrease your budget, because it was a one-time allocation. And so it looks like the budget last year was $55,000, when it really wasn't, because if you look at the budget line, it includes all those other projects in there. So that line is actually gonna be less.
So what you're saying,
when we proposed this, it'll look like it was less than.
Absolutely.
Because all those are combined.
Right, because the $80,000 was the three phase, and the $45,000 was the ADA left.
Right, and it does get confusing, because we actually spend that money sort of in this year. It gets very.
When the March vote occurs, they're appropriating money for the following school year. So what they vote in March is your operating budget and any other additional warrant articles that gets approved. And then that all gets added together. And if it doesn't get approved, then it's just the operating budget that was voted.
So the budget the town voted on last year
is the $5,555,000.
Does not include the warrant articles. But the budget we're looking at now to compare the new budget to does include
yes.
warrant articles.
Yes.
So when people see it on the ballot, however, they will see the differential between the two ballot numbers will be accurate for what
that's correct.
Right. However, what we're paying attention to when we make these comparisons includes the warrant article, which we'll vote on separately.
Correct.
So it'll be different.
Correct.
Yes. And talk about, to me, confusing. In a way.
Well, that's why
it's difficult to compare year to year to year. So.
But that'll be a talking point. The big difference in that line is going to be those warrant articles that we had. And again, it's only one time addition.
And you'll see, maybe you've seen it already when we look at this year's budget later at our next meeting. I had asked Marie, and she very quickly got it done, which I appreciate very much. It pulled out the warrant article so we can see what line they're in, and we know what it is, because it always used to be, wait a minute, why is that so high? What's it doing there? So, really appreciate that.
The other thing is, this is the last year that Rollinsford High School students will be attending Summersworth.
Correct.
So, tuitions will now be out of state. We had some local and had some out of state. So, so you'll see a decrease there, but in Marshwood currently, there's a small group of 12th graders, very small,
yes.
that they're leaving. And then if you take the 6th graders that are coming up, it's still 25. So there's still gonna be a greater number of students attending Marshwood based on just that ratio.
Right.
Do you create a sheet that compares line to line to line from 1 year to the next year to the next year? Like, can we see our maintenance line? Like, do you already create something?
It's in here. And then when you get the budget packet, I think there's a 3 year actual.
Is there? Okay.
Yeah,
it's a 3 or 2 year actual.
It's a 2 year actual. It's the current year.
Budget,
and then it's the proposed one that we're going to be voting on. Budget, and it does get confusing to draw a graph for 5 years, because then warrant articles get added in.
Right.
So other questions on this? So Marie, anything else you'd like to share with us?
I think Kate's going to bring forth what the CIP.
Yeah, we are going to talk about CIP, but in terms of putting the budget together.
No, are we good?
Right.
Yeah, well, as soon as I get the tuition numbers, then we're ready.
Right, and I'm sorry, did you say 8% for the health is what you're paying?
That's what I put in, yes. I'm hoping it comes in low.
And for Primex, we know it can't be more than 9, we're on that plan because we've done so well, apparently.
Have you already gone through this page one, did you already?
That's our current budget, which we'll be discussing in our next meeting. So unless you have see something on that you would like to see addressed in our budget for next year, the fall. We're now, this is a budget meeting on next year's budget. And it's really hard because we're trying to come up with a budget that's, you know, a year from now.
Okay, so then I actually don't need to question anything about the warrant articles that were...
No, you can question them in the next meeting.
Yes, okay.
Okay, all right. I think that works, right?
That works.
Okay. All right, so if we were not having a school board meeting tonight, I would be at the town's CIP meeting, scheduled for tonight. But to also get things sort of up to date there as well.
But you can miss out on these.
Well, I have some general questions, actually, though this could apply.
Okay, yeah.
This could apply. I apologize if it doesn't, but you can shut me down. PT and OT services, does that generally, change from year to year, or how is that estimated? I'm just curious if we, is it based upon the current needs that you have, and then
the rationale? It's based on actual and then a percentage of students that if they're going to stay in the district, and then whatever increase the outside services, contracted services that we use to provide those services, what the cost is kind of an increase for that, because there's always an increase when you contract out the services.
Okay, and so the same I would imagine then for the audit services, the legal services?
Well, legal services you can't really budget for because we look at over time what we've actually spent in legal services, because some years you may not spend anything, and then other times you may need to use it for different various purposes.
Come up.
So that one is really difficult to budget for, because it could go either way.
Yeah. And actually that's a good one to think about for next year, because we will be renegotiating with Marshwood next year to extend the contract. We're not really renegotiating, we'll be negotiating to extend the contract for 4 years. That starts next year. So it'd be good to make sure that we have enough in there to see what we spent in our last negotiations with them. Shouldn't be quite as difficult because we're just looking to extend the contract and maybe change a few things, but that's a good point to bring up.
So currently, last year that we closed, we budgeted legal services, regular legal services, $14,000. We only spent $9,000. So we still had $5,000 that we hadn't spent. So that line is flat. So depending on how the board wants to go, we could increase it or we could decrease it. Mm-hmm. But that's what's been budgeted. And I'm just telling you what we spent last year. We spent about $914,000. So I don't know.
And we should probably look at what we spent four years ago.
Yeah, but the rates changed.
let's look what we budgeted. Yeah, I mean, I know it's probably gone up.
I could do that.
There's still probably litigation that you actually involved in 4 years ago that was why it was higher, because you were involved in some litigation.
Well, it took a lot longer. You hadn't actually developed the contract.
Well, there was that too. There was a lot of legal stuff going on. Must have been before my time. But okay. All right. But the excellent question. Anything else right now, Andrea, on that?
No, I think that's it. For now.
Okay. So we'll spend a little time now on CIP. Kate, a lot of the stuff, we've knocked off some of the stuff as we had hoped to do, and we were able to do it as we designated some of the money that we had last year, the savings of a teacher's salary, which helped a lot, helped us due to a resignation that we did not replace that teacher, and so we were able to knock off a lot of stuff. So do you all have, do people have the list? Is there another?
No, actually, I've been wanting.
Three wanted, three for yourself.
So I, it's good, have a, well, you can, we can look at some of these things going on, and most of this is based on the IEB study, correct? Of the things that a lot of it, a lot of what Dick has seen and needs, knows needs to happen.
Yeah, I think there's definitely items that are on the IEBA study. And then he also, based on his experience here, he feels are most pressing at this time, were sort of how this was prioritized. We also had the land security 2 years ago, and then did their analysis and had some suggestions for us as well.
Yes, and they and that was part of also helping them with, they did the grant with the cameras and stuff. So these are, and I, they certainly all seem familiar for any of us who have closely read the IEBA study over and over and over again. You know, the annex roof being one of the next big things, the annex and kindergarten roof being one of the next big things. And I believe this price is still from that study, the IEBA study. So the prices are out of date, so we would have to get new prices on these. But these give us relationships of price. I'd like to talk for just a minute, if we look at the top where it talks about cupola, main building windows, and the main building roof. So those three items are on the main building, which we are now on the National Historical Register. And should we have the time and energy, and I will say it takes a bit of time and energy, we could try to raise matching funds, we could try to receive grants. If we do that, and sometimes it's a good thing to do, and sometimes it isn't. So the pros to it are that we get matching funds, but we have to raise matching funds. So if we have to do a cupola for $110,000, we have to raise $55,000 somehow. And whoever the entity is, the historical, the New Hampshire Historical Group, has a lien on our building for their part of it for 20 years or something. So that we can't do anything then to the work they've put money into or anything else, I believe. I think it even goes beyond that without their approval. So as soon as we start going down that path, they start having the ability to approve or not approve what we do to the building. We will never lose our National Historic Designation. We will never lose that, as far as I know. That's true. So the building itself is that. So it doesn't mean that we have to do it that way. And when we look at some of the price differences that we see here, you can see it right there at the top, you know, the cupola.
The windows, I think, in the store, I think this is somewhere around like 280 or something. This is just...
Yeah, and I did not bring that piece with that. Piece with it.
Getting matching funds, we have to do it within historical guidelines or enough.
Well, we could have big sale. I mean, we could, you know,
we have to do the work. So the cupola, for example, within some historical guidelines of how we do the work.
Yes.
Not how we raise the money. Yeah. I'm pretty sure we don't have to follow any historical fundraising guidelines.
Yes, we have to do it to
a store. So we'll have to meet some guidelines that they...
Very much so, which is why the price goes up so much. And have to use someone who's certified in doing historical work and all that stuff.
Well, this benefits the town. I mean, this town is willing to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars, wherever it costs, to repair that eyesore that's on Main Street. And, you know, they should be able to pony up to repair a building that's on the historic register. I mean, we're talking $50,000. The other thing is that if it isn't done, it's going to get worse. It'll probably cost more. So it's just, you look up at it, How much longer is this thing going to stay up there?
And if I'm hearing you right, Tom, you're talking about, though, just doing it, not necessarily going down the historical and matching grant line.
Well, no, we'll need to have a matching grant, but the remainder of it, I think, you know, this, I mean, we're going to get at least $50,000 in matching grants towards this.
But there's no guarantee that we will get any money. They have to have it available. It has to be, that's part, and it's at least, even if we started the process right now, it's at least 2 years away.
So how?
So those are other things that we have to think about. The cupola is an eyesore. What is the first thing, Connie, you said about the building?
Not on TV.
Oh, no. All right, everyone notices the cupola.
We can apply for a grant and then say no thank you?
We can.
Okay. So I say we find out, maybe Peter can answer the question as to whether the lien and the work situation is only on the piece that they have helped us fund, or whether it's the whole building.
Yeah, what are the restrictions?
I want to know. Yeah.
I think we can find the answers to those. They have a very good website and places to get the answers. And so the time and energy needs to be put into that.
I think it needs to be done. I mean, I know it's not like, good grief, people are waking up in the middle of the night screaming, what's going to happen to the cupola? But the honest truth is, you drive by it and you see it, and you're like, that thing is really falling apart. And it needs to be fixed. I mean, we've been talking about it for a long time, but I think it's actually gotten progressively worse since the beginning.
Maybe we could get some help from the Association for Rollinsford Culture and History.
Yeah, or the Rollinsford Historical
Art.
No, there's also the Celia Leopold. There's also an historical committee, what's it called? Nancy, you know the name, Nancy?
Historical Committee.
Yeah, the Historical Committee.
They haven't become a commission yet. If they become a commission, then they can intake money.
So I have a quick question. There, has it been settled that you will go the historical route as opposed to just fixing it outright?
That's a good question, and I don't think it's been settled in the board which way we'll go.
No,
I think we're looking for some political questions.
Answers. Okay. As far as the lien that they'll have on the building, what other restrictions they put on it. I like those answers.
And that's good, but this is something that we as a board have to take on that work. That's not work we can offload, I don't think, onto anyone else. So,
well, I think the concern really is.
So we have to find out who here has the time and energy to get those questions answered. That's.
Because, I mean, if it's going to be included, I think in any of our go forward budgeting plans, even long term, if there's really no guarantee, you know, because we would go after those matching funds, clearly, we want to go that route.
Well, is there a difference? I guess my next question would be, is there a difference in the estimate of doing the work historically versus?
Yes.
Sure.
Yes.
How much of a difference?
It is over twice as much to do it historically than it is to do it not historically. The way it will look will be substantially the same.
So what you see on the first line was this cupola $50,000 to $110,000. So $50,000 is the estimate we got to have the cupola done to look beautiful, just not to have the same wood or same material. It would look the same as it would, I think, if it was historically preserved, but it would be modern day materials. And, you know, $110,000 is the estimate that we were given by the, it was Aaron, I can't remember.
He's a historical architect.
An estimate of $110,000 to do it to the level of specification and requirement for the historical register. So
the cost to the town would be the same,
roughly.
The same, essentially.
And you would not have to
do only one.
Keep within their restrictions.
And be restricted.
And potentially the modern materials would last longer.
I don't know all of those details.
Right.
I think it's a good guess.
It's also timeline. I think that's the other piece that I think about. We're talking about this already it's an issue not only just because it's ugly, but it's wrapped in chicken wire right now because pieces were falling off, which is a safety
that's
issue.
That's a safety issue.
So, I mean, and ultimately that's going to impact the roof that's around it if it's not taken care of. And I think when you're talking about, this is just my feelings, but it's already been 3 years that we've been in this process, and we're not making the headway we need to make it happen sooner rather than later. And I wonder what happens, timeliness, if you're looking now at 5 or 6 more years before all of it lines up to happen. I think that's something you guys have to consider about how immediately you want some of this to happen.
And Judy, did I understand you correctly when you said, irrespective of what you do to the cupola, the building does stay on the register?
Correct. The building itself is on the historical register. Okay. And remains so, unless we knock it down. And they can't keep us from knocking it down. And they can.
They would be able to prevent you from knocking it down.
I'm not sure that's exactly true, though. I'm not sure that's exactly true.
Well, and that's something worth finding out.
I think there are restrictions as to what you can do because it's based on its original structure. So, but I think internally you have to do whatever you have to do, but outside, I think they're kind of tough with that. But I mean, you're right. That is something you have to.
And you are right. I did misspeak. As long as it remains a school, it remains.
Well, so maybe we should get a quote, an updated quote, for what it would cost to just update that, update it to the $50,000 quote. And see what it costs.
I think it's worth getting a quote on that, and I think it's worth, I know where the websites are, and I can take a look on the websites to see about what sort of leads they have on us, and I can get sort of those answers quickly.
Do you think folks in town that have a strong feelings about whether or not they would like to see it historically
preserved,
or if, if it's the same cost.
The strong feelings I have heard, and please everyone jump in, dear God, fix the cupola. Anyone else want that? Right. What have other people heard?
I haven't heard anything ever, actually.
Now, whether or not we go the historical route, we could still fundraise because the cupola, I believe, has a chance to be a fundraiser because people who have graduated from this school walk in and go,
I did it,
and
back to the
future.
Yep. I think it should be a fundraiser. It feels like kind of a frivolous thing to ask the town to pay for. That's how I feel about it.
So we can start fundraising, and when we reach the 50,000, have it done. Well, that's an interesting. I think we should keep that in mind as we look at things. Yeah,
going to be some people's reaction. Why are we spending $50,000 on this?
Well, what is the alternative? Remove it? That's what I was going to ask. I mean, because if it's becoming not safe,
right? The main building roof is on this plan, projected out a few years, but we could rip it off and redo the roof.
Yeah, and so that's another good question to ask. Do we remain a historical building if we remove a particular historical feature?
Yeah,
these are all very good questions. We'll get the answers.
Or is it cheaper to do it all together at the same time, right? The cupola and the roof.
Like take it off now and then do it.
Oh, no, you have to wait until when I do it.
Yeah.
Well, if anybody asks me, I think it adds character. I think it's really, it really, you look at the building and say, wow, that's
right.
Nice.
Well,
it really assess, it speaks to the time that this building was built. And I get it, everything costs money, but even the things that I thought would have been layups in front of the town, like asbestos removal, all of a sudden became the third layup. So I don't, there's no rhyme or reason.
Yeah.
So
we're fighting for every penny.
Yeah, no, I mean we shouldn't have to, but I think that this is now it's collapsing on itself. It's being held with chicken wire. That's pretty pathetic. I mean, I get it why it's being done, but if folks are like, well, we shouldn't put the money into it next year or this year, or when? when? When is it going to get done? And it's only going to get worse. So,
I think, so let's keep this conversation going until we can find out before our next meeting. I'll double check with y'all so that I can find on the websites of things for those kinds of things. The other stuff that's in here, it's pretty well laid out. I think everyone can see all these things. I know the big ticket items, the 100,000, 300,000, 400,000 items are from the IPEA study. They were all in there. If you look all the way down to the bottom with ceiling tiles throughout the school, plumbing throughout the school, some of these items are being addressed piecemeal and are not at this cost. Certainly the items that are being addressed, like we did some bathrooms this last year because we had the money and were able to do it. So that what was not done were all the things behind the walls where we didn't replace all the pipe because it didn't need to be replaced. So they're being done piecemeal as we go on. So just to know that some of those things are happening.
And am I understanding this correctly, that the paving and the annex windows was supposed to be for the budget that we're talking about tonight, but that we already did that? I'm confused about the year.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Those were things that we were able to do, again, with money we had last
okay.
year.
Okay. Got it. Thank you.
Last year. Yes.
I know, that's why I said on the budget, so which we know we're talking about budget.
So we have a few more, so these are things that we can look, take a look at these and see if we have more questions. We have another budget meeting, and for the next one, we will have a draft budget together for us. Any other questions, comments right now? So we will rearrange ourselves, and we have 2 minutes to rearrange ourselves.
Yes.